And after
Jim
that, he
Beck,
had
Corey,
had a
and
debate with
Maury,
he had five
Colby,
debates with
Stairs.
Ah.
Still now,
with that,
you
you
are
assume
not
that he would have done some things and
but slowly,
you know,
slowly,
discarded
okay,
his car,
nice.
Or
Espera,
perhaps,
no?
You know, gone back to
Beck, okay.
Being in,
gone
to VLA
like
or something,
Stair,
or
Stair.
Still,
Sami Allahu Liman Hamida.
Sami Allahu Liman Hamida.
Okay, we are waiting a little bit. After waiting a little bit, we will go to the town. It's called Sijda.
Sijda.
Yeah. So, how to Sijda? By saying Takbir Allah.
Seriously, guys, you know, I can see many people online and many of you could be his fans.
Allah.
Seriously, if you're there,
Allah.
Do, Allah.
Allah.
Then we will go back to the
know that
stand position, okay?
You know,
by saying Allah.
Well, you might say, why am I doing an online reputation?
Nose first,
well, see,
yeah. And said,
what is
no mouth, no mouth.
No,
no.
What is happening
is that somebody going to that like
this guy.
Then go again. Allahu Akbar.
الله أكبر
سبحان ربي الأعلى
سبحان ربي الأعلى
ربي الأعلى
سبحان ربي الأعلى
سبحان
ربي الأعلى
okay we'll go back to the our standing position okay
yes.
الله
أكبر
okay like
yes.
This we will go back to the standing position
this is
first first mean measured thing okay then we will sit okay الله
Okay. So, all right. So, coming back to this, he had a few debates with me, and then we were supposed to be having a string of more debates. And unfortunately, instead of coming for the remainder set of debates, what he did was that he started posting online videos. And again, this was just a rehash of the same arguments. And over a period of a few weeks, he posted like what 12 videos, and then okay, I posted one because. He asked for zakat online. I don't ask for any zakat or anything online, and I have work to do. So, but then again, I thought, okay, let me get back to doing this. And so here I am. And so I'll be starting off on the first thing is the first thing that I'll be doing is I'll be taking you through what he said, and I'll be showing you what is the presentation I had made. And if you have any queries, do drop that down in the comment section, and I will take it up. And really, this is going to be interesting. I had tagged Dr. Sayed also and his motley crew, but I don't see many of them having turned up for this, obviously. And so in case you have any of your Islamic friends, or if in case you could reach out to Dr. Sayed, then do reach out to him, and perhaps, you know, he might come. So this is like an open challenge for him. So instead of doing this table tennis, why don't you have some guts and come for a live debate? I'm willing to debate you even now without any preparations on the topic and whatever points you've said. I'm willing to debate you even now. I have tagged him, and I probably might be here also in a different pseudonym. So that is also possible because, you know, all that permutation combinations are allowed in Islam. So what can happen is that we can I can take you through what he said, and again it is the same rubbish you know arguments from Zakir Naik time, and I answered it, and it's such a sad thing that I have to repeat it again. So okay, now just for the sake of clarity, what I have on the right side of the screen is not a PowerPoint, okay? That's his video. All right, so don't say that I'm showing a PowerPoint of Dr. Sayed. It's not. That's his video, which I downloaded, and it's been put. So, I'll just take you through that, and then you can just you know decide how to, and then we'll just see how that can be addressed. And so here we go. And as I said, if you have any queries, we can always you know take it up. You know, and you can just put in your queries. And again, it's an open challenge for any of the Muslims. And if you have any Muslim friends, please ask them to be online. And this is going to be fun. As much as it is, time is required, I'll be sitting here and answering your queries. It can be a live back and forth, and it need not just be a monologue between me and just from my side. So I'm getting tired of this, you know, so-called refutation videos. So I'm doing this live for the sake of the viewers and for the earnest Islamic seekers. So over the next few days, I'll be going through all the videos one by one and closing it out. And if you have any of those contacts, Shoaib Sayed, ask him to come for the debate or at least be here for the online, you know, Facebook discussion. So here I go.
He started with this question, are the rituals not pagan practice? And that day I gave several references from the Bible that Prophet Abraham, Moses, Joshua, Jesus, angels all did fall on their faces and prayed to God. Genesis chapter 17 verse number 3, Abraham fell on his face and God talked with him. Moses and...
Alright, so let me just rewind that back and look at the ridiculous, you know...
Joshua, Jesus, angels all did fall on their faces and prayed to God. Genesis chapter 17 verse number 3, Abraham fell on his face and God talked with him.
Alright, so did you hear what he said? Abraham fell on his face and God spoke with him. Can you give me a single instance in the entire Quran where even Allah spoke to the Prophet of Islam? No one. And even Aisha says in one of the hadiths that if anybody says that Allah, Muhammad spoke to Allah directly, that person is lying. So that is one of the Sahih hadiths. And here he says God spoke to Abraham. Yes, God spoke to Abraham. And, you know, just think about it. You know, it's beyond words. There is this entity, right? I'm using the word entity, who's beyond space and time, infinitely powerful and infinitely intelligent. He knows your past, present, future, and he created everything out of nothing. And if that entity, I cannot even say person, because when I say person, it typically means more like a human being sort. And just imagine, if that entity is standing in front of you, what will happen to you? Wouldn't you, like, first of all, you'll be lucky to be alive in the first place. And let's assume God allows you to be alive in his presence. And would you have the guts to remain standing on your feet? So many times, you know, I go to church, and I'm sure that so many of my Christian brothers and sisters go to church, and we get down on your knees to pray. You know, it's when we realize the power of the Almighty, that's the least. It's not we can do, it is what we are led to. Now, Abraham fell on his face. It's God standing in front of you. What do you expect is going to happen next? So here he says, and
Moses and Aaron, Numbers chapter 20 verse number 6, Moses and Aaron fell on their faces and prayed to God. That day he said that they did not pray, they were doing their prostrating in respect. No, this is not in respect. They were praying to God. Moses, Jesus, Joshua, people, in Revelation chapter 7 verse number 11, all the angels stood around about the shrine, about the throne, and about the elders and the four beasts, and fell before the throne on their faces and worshipped God.
Yes, so, but in the same way that I said that day, nowhere in the Holy Bible is a practice instituted. They fell on their face and they prayed. And what Dr. Sayed is trying to say over here is that Muslims also get down on their faces like this and they do something. And so that is what it is. And that's what they say, that this is all about Moses, Aaron, Jesus, all getting down on their face and praying to God. And even the holy angels. Yeah. So even when I am in heaven in front of my God, by the grace of my God, I will surely not have the guts to stand in front of him. I'll surely not be able to stand and, you know, speak in any manner. Obviously, under no circumstances would I be able to, stand there and speak about myself or anything on those lines. I will be down on my face. So it was not out of respect. I don't think I said out of respect. Even if I did, I doubt I would. But it would be more out of the sheer magnificence of the living God. And he is there in front of you. If you are not vaporized, you would be down on your face in front of him. But nowhere it is put across as an institution that This is how you should be praying, or this is what you should be, this is how you should be doing it. Let me ask any self-respecting Muslim, the way you pray when you're doing a salat and all those, you know, sitting up, standing, and, you know, touching your feet and, you know, touching your head down and touching your eyes and touching your head, what all calisthenics you do, there is a sequence to that. Can you show me any such sequence in the Holy Bible? There is none. Because when I'm talking to my Father in heaven, I can be anywhere and I can be in whichever way that I am and I can pray to Him. Unfortunately, for a Muslim who is nothing more than a slave of Allah, he doesn't have more of a choice other than doing all those calisthenics which is required, because it's basically a ritual that you're doing. For me, as a Christian, it is not really a ritual. It is more of speaking to my Father in heaven.
So it clearly says that they worship God. People worship like prostrating. So it is, this is not a pagan practice. Moses and Aaron, they performed ablution. Zephaniah.
Yes. So he says Moses and Aaron performed ablution. And he cites Exodus. Yes. And even when.
Clearly says that they worship God. People worship like prostrating. So it is, this is not a pagan practice. Moses and Aaron, they performed ablution. Zephaniah speaks about praying in a pure language and calling for prayer, Shechem, and praying shoulder to shoulder. We Muslims pray in the mouth shoulder to shoulder. All these references I gave that day. Nehemiah chapter 8, verse number 4 to 6. Speaking about raising the hands, we Muslims raise our hands. Then bowing, ruku position.
Alright, there are just so many points to cover. Over here, as I said, everything he's taking one, you know, point of, you know, the way people showed their reverence to the Almighty. And okay, coming to the point of the evolution, even the Levites were supposed to cleanse themselves, wash their hands and feet before we go in the presence of the Almighty. Even I do. Even when I go to church or we sit for prayers in the house, we wash our hands and feet as a mark of respect, as a mark of, you know, even when Moses is, you know, came in front of the burning bush, God told him to remove his sandals because this is holy ground. So that is a way we are asked to come. It is not that now, even, okay, let me put it in this way. When a Muslim goes, does his ablution, that is, you know, washing his hands and feet, there is a sequence even for that. That is how you are supposed to be praying, how you'll be, you know, washing your hands and feet, and you'll be doing this, and you'll be washing your ears, you'll be washing your eyes. So there is a ritual. Everything is a practiced ritual, unfortunately, for a Muslim. Unfortunately, I say for a Muslim, because you are slaves. I am a child of God. There's a huge difference. And as I said, you know, there is, if you put down a message, I will send you that book, I Dare to Call Him Father, you know, by Bilkis. It is there even on Amazon. And I'll send that book to you at my cost without accepting anybody's zakat, actually, because my God provides for me. And so there it is. So we do what we do, because that is the way I show my respect to my God. And there is nowhere where it is written that if you don't wash your hands and feet, you are impure in the sight of Almighty. Nowhere. Can a Muslim say that? Is it anywhere written in the Bible that you have to wash your hands and feet if you go, and in this specific manner? And let me tell you about the sorry state of affairs in Islam. Even the way they wash their hands and feet, it is there in the hadith. It is there in the hadith. That is, even the way that first they'll wash their hands like this in the upper direction, and then the other hand like this. And, you know, even the water they'll take and they'll part the beard, and they'll, you know, you must have seen Muslims do that, right? They'll put the finger in middle of the beard, and they do like this. And that is done because people saw Muhammad do that. Everything is nothing more than a slave market for a Muslim. Everything is nothing more than a slave market for a Muslim. But for me, when I do it, it's of my own free will. It is not that I'm mandated, but that's how it is. And here again we say, he says in Zephaniah 3:9, let us hear that, what he says, or rather rambles on and on about. Let us see, this is such a joke, and really, you should think about it. And again, I'm requesting my brothers and sisters who are watching this program live, I will wait for Dr. Syed to come online. If there is a Muslim, come online and talk to me on this. This is an open challenge, because this is like an ongoing nonsense that is rambled by the Islamic world. Where, okay, Jesus prayed like a Muslim, or Muslims pray like Jesus, and Christians don't pray like Jesus, and all these things. So here he says,
this is I gave that day. Nehemiah chapter 8, verse number 4 to 6, speaks about praying in a pure language and calling for prayer, Shechem.
Okay, now listen to this very carefully, okay?
Praying shoulder to shoulder. We Muslims pray in the mouth shoulder to shoulder.
Okay. So he quotes Zephaniah 3:9, and he says, for then will I turn the people to a pure language. And he assumes over here that this pure language is Arabic. On what basis? I don't know. That they may all call upon the name of the Lord to serve him with one unison. It basically means unison comes from the, you get the word unity in that, together. And he translates this word in a fraudulent manner, in a makar, deceitful manner, as shoulder to shoulder, and say, Christian, here they stood shoulder to shoulder and they prayed, and Muslims stand shoulder to shoulder in a Muslim. So there are so many problems with this. Look at the deceitfulness, and as I quoted the last time, the basic problem in Islam is Quran chapter 5 verses 101, where Allah says that do not ask questions. If you ask questions, you will lose your faith. Look it up, 5 verses 101 and 102. Chapter 5 of the Quran, verses 101 and 102. I'll take that up again in my next session in detail, because somehow Shoaib Sayyid has come up with so-called responses to that. Now, so here he says, 3 verses 9, he says, okay, it is people standing shoulder to shoulder and praying. So, this is just one verse. Show me that Abraham prayed like this, shoulder to shoulder. Moses prayed like this, shoulder to shoulder. And when Jesus was praying, he asked all his disciples, please stand one after the another, or one next to one another, one behind the other, shoulder to shoulder, and do all this exercise while I'm praying. Forget the exercise, even stand like that and says. Because the Holy Bible is so clear and so wonderful, and Holy Bible is so beautiful, and it says that you have to, wherever two or more of you are there, I am there with you. Wherever two or more of you are praying together, I am there with you. That is the Holy Bible. And here he says shoulder to shoulder. So show me where it is. So in the previous previous clips, as you've seen, he says, Abraham fell on their face, Jesus fell on their face, Adam fell on their face. So many people fell on their face and prayed. And so Muslims fall on their faces and pray, which is totally wrong, because that's one of the things they do, not everything. And here he says they even stood shoulder to shoulder. There is no evidence of Jesus, Abraham, Moses, anyone saying or even calling the Israelites. Now the Israelites were almost 2 million when they came out of Egypt, and they would get up and there would be prayers. Even the Levites, there is an entire tribe, thousands of people. Nowhere it is written that the Levites would stand at specific times of the day shoulder to shoulder and they would be praying in this manner. Nowhere. Show me where it is. I challenge you to show me that. And so this is a basic cherry picking fallacy, where he's picking up verses that is suiting his convenience and making a practice out of it just to explain their pagan practices of Islam. So he says, and who prays? Look at the slide, it is there on your right, and on my left rather. And who prays joining shoulder to shoulder in the mosque but Muslims? So now, let's assume there will be, I'm sure that so many of the Muslims and even Dr. Sayyid would be praying at home alone, doing the namaz at home alone. So there is no one standing shoulder to shoulder at this time, because he's praying alone. Like so many billions of Muslims who are praying at home in their offices or whatever be the case. So in that case, are those prayers wrong prayers or the wrong way of doing namaz? Because he just made a practice out of it and says, who prays joining shoulder to shoulder? And if he says that this was a practice instituted by the Holy Bible, by the one true God, So in that case, when the Muslim is praying at home and just praying alone, standing shoulder to shoulder to no one, then is he compromising or is he violating the requirements and the tenets of Islam is a question that, Shoaib Syed needs to ask and answer on that. So let's move ahead. This is going to be fun, and I still await the Muslims to, come up with some sort of a, response on these points that I'm making. If you have anything to say, this is the right time, because I'm getting tired of this, up and down that keeps happening, that Muslims, Muslims are more Christians than the Christians themselves. So old age, age old nonsense circulated by Zakir Naik and the likes of Ahmed Didat. So I even ask my Christian friends who are there online to put in your questions, put in your thoughts, and going ahead, you can even join me on the screen, maybe from the next episode onwards. So here we go to the next one.
All these references I gave that day, Nehemiah chapter 8 verse number 4 to 6, speaking about raising the hands, we must raise our hands, then bowing, ruku position, prostration, it is all mentioned in the Bible. So that day, I...
Now again, he reads, the argument gets, crazier by the minute. And he reads Nehemiah now 8, chapter 8, verses 4 to 6. And Ezra the scribe stood up upon a pulpit of wood which they had made for the purpose. And beside him stood Mattathiah and Shema and Anal. I hope I'm pronouncing this right. And on his right, there stood a few more people. And Ezra opened the... there's a long list of names. I'm not able to pronounce it rather. And then the next verse says, verse 5, it says... And Ezra opened the book in the sight of the people, for he was above all the people. And when he opened, all the people stood up. And Ezra blessed the Lord, the great Lord, the great God. And all the people answered, Amen, Amen, with lifting up the hands. And they bowed their heads and worshipped the Lord with the faces on the ground. Amazing. Doesn't that happen in church sometimes? I do sometimes. When I lift up my hands, it is in adoration of the Almighty. And again, bringing back the same argument that I had said the last time, just a few minutes back, that is, now, in one part you said they fell on their faces, in another part you said they stood shoulder to shoulder, now you are saying that they raised their hands. So, again, the same argument I'm saying, that is, show me that as an instituted practice, in the sense, first you will stand up, then you will keep your hands on the on your thighs, then you'll sit down, then you'll do... There is even this ridiculous practice in that Muslims do. They'll turn their head on the left, on the right, then on the left, then they'll do up, they'll do down. This neck exercises they do, and so many, they'll touch the shoulders over here, something, so many things they do. There is a sequence. And I'm sure that, okay, now you can see in the background also the Muslims are doing like this, and now here, see, he's teaching. You can see in the background video of mine that Imam is teaching the people how to offer namaz. So they keep the hand like this in front and then they go back like this, and, whatever. So that is a sequence in that. You can't just do this at random. I challenge Dr. Shoaib to show that this can be done at random. I challenge any self-respecting Muslim to show that these things, these exercises can be done at random, can be done as per your convenience, and you can do whenever you feel like it. I can raise up my hands in church whenever I feel like it. I can bow down in church whenever I feel like it. Whenever I'm led to by the Spirit of the Lord. Whenever I feel it in my heart. It's not bound on me. It's not bound on any Christian. And neither is there a mandate like that in the Bible. They did this. And for me, this is so beautiful. I read this somewhere and then I told my children also that is, they asked, why do you raise your hands like this? Why do you do that? My kids asked me. This really happened. Just think about it. It's such a great privilege to be a Christian. And, I remember giving this example to my child. And I said, let's assume you and I are walking and we enter a lift, an elevator, And I can see this thing in the background, all right? All these calisthenics that they do, and there are different names also for that. See, and the imam is teaching it. So there is a class on how to do yoga, I'm sorry, on how to do namaz anyway. And see, it is even written what to recite when you are bending at the waist. So all these recitations are there. So anyway, coming back to the anecdote of her life, and so I told him, we enter an elevator, and there is my I tell him, when you enter the elevator and there are four more people who enter the elevator, you know what you used to do when you were a child? He said, yeah. I asked him what. He said, you would ask me to lift you up in my arms, right? And he would say, yeah. And I asked him, then how did you motion me to lift you up? He said, no, I'll lift up my hands like this, meaning lift me up. It is a very close, it's a very near to heart motion of closeness to somebody. It's like when I want to hug my child or my mother or my wife or my sister, anyone, or my friend, I put out my hands like this. Come to me, just give me a hug. Bring me close to you. So when I lift up my hands to my Abba, my Father in heaven, it is a basic cry or a request to pull me close to you. But for a Muslim, it's not. You are a slave. You are not a child. You are a slave. You will never see Allah ever in eternity, assuming there is a Jannah. We'll come to the Islamic practice, Islamic understanding of Jannah also, and Jannah. We'll come to that, where it'll just be unlimited sex and wine and women and everything. We'll come to that. But there is no Allah over there. There is no Allah. It's a disgusting place. So we'll come to that, but that's we'll move on from now. So here it is, Muslims do this, and he says, are they pagan practice? And I'm, yes, it is a pagan practice, because what you are doing is that you are following a cult behavior. What a Christian does, when a Christian does all this kneeling down, standing up, falling on the face, or lifting up the hands, it is a heart-driven act. That's what it is. There is no mandate. Show me a challenge, a Muslim, to show me this in the Quran. So let's move ahead.
Talking about raising their hands, we Muslims raise our hands. Then bowing, ruku position, prostration. It is all mentioned in the Bible. So that day, I gave all these references. I quoted Psalms chapter 84, number 46 about Bakka, mentioned in Bible. Bakka is mentioned in chapter 3, verse 96 in the Quran also. So it is the same Kaaba, Bakka.
So before, you know, you have to understand what on earth is going on. And listen to this again, this crazy, argument.
Psalms chapter 84, verse number 46 about Bakka, mentioned in Bible. Bakka is mentioned in chapter 3, verse 96 in the Quran also. So
hence, I am not a Muslim. Psalms chapter 84, verse 4 to 6. Blessed are they that dwell in thy house. They will still be praising thee, Selah. Blessed is the man whose strength is in thee, and whose hearts are the way or ways of them who, passing through the valley of Baca, make it a well. The rain also filleth the pool. So it just says, who passing through the valley of Baca. Now there are so many issues with this. First of all, he interprets this as this being Mecca, and his argument is Mecca is Mecca. I don't know. He's not given, if you notice, he's not given a singular, archaeological response or evidence or a geographical argument that can be accepted that Mecca is Mecca. I think it is just because, the Islamic, okay, it sounds like Mecca, Mecca, it's just a... B and M, it looks the same anyway. B goes like this and you just turn it around, it becomes an M. So Bakka is Makkah. I think that is his argument, I believe. That is how a Muslim thinks, I guess. No sane person will ever think like that. And here he says, Bakka is Makka gives evidence, no evidence, gives absolutely no evidence. And the word simply says, who passing through the valley of Mecca make it a well. Even if it was, it simply says, who passing through, blessed is the man whose strength is in thee, whose hearts are the ways of them, who passing through the valley of Mecca make it a well. So first of all, is Mecca a valley? Okay, I don't think so. Second is that, make it a well, how does it designate Bakka or Makka as a place of worship for a Christian or a Jew? For a Christian, for a Jew rather, from the time it started of institutionalized worship, it was Jerusalem only. Even after the temple got destroyed, it got remade in Jerusalem only. So how come you can say that Bakka and Makka is the same when Makka or Bakka, whatever on earth you want to call it, was never a place of institutionalized worship for a Christian or a Jew at all? It was always Jerusalem. And the point is, when Muhammad started his career, prophetic career, and he wanted to entice the Jews and call himself as a prophet of the Jews, he had designated Jerusalem as the place of worship. And when that failed, when the Jews, realized that, knew in out front that he was a fake prophet, they rejected him. And then when he came back in power, he changed that to Mecca. Before that, even for Muhammad, the place of worship was Jerusalem, never Mecca. Mecca came after, when the Jews refused to accept his prophethood. Going ahead.
It is the same Kaaba, Mecca. Mecca is the original name of Mecca. The history of running between Safa and Marwa is in remembrance of Hajra, wife of Abraham. Genesis chapter 16 verse number 3. Running for water for thirsty crying baby Ishmael on the floor at the Makkah. This is not a pagan practice. How can you say this is a pagan?
Now, anyway, he says Hajra and Safa, Marwa, history of running between Safa and Marwa is in remembrance of Hajra, Hagar as it is called, wife of Abraham. So, he says, this is in remembrance of Hagar running for water for the baby Ishmael. Well, if you're doing it in remembrance of that, first of all, the basic problem with that is, when you're calling it as a practice, where is that institutionalized in the Holy Bible? Anyone, whether it is Moses or Abraham or anyone practicing it? No one. It is a pagan practice.
Pagan practice. Fasting the 10th Muharram is not a pagan practice. Not at all. Prophet Muhammad saw the Jews fasting on that day. In remembrance of Moses, Prophet made it recommended to fast 2 days in remembrance of Moses. 9th, 10th Muharram or 10th, 11th Muharram. So how can it be a pagan practice? It is not a pagan practice.
Okay. So here I'll pull up my other presentation that I had done earlier. And I'm just pulling up the presentation. Just give me a second. All right. All right. So this is what I had shown earlier when during the debate. And you can also see it online on the screen over here. And so Safa and Marwa, as was written, and I'm just quoting it out for you. Yeah, I'm just adjusting it so you can read it. Give me a second. Okay, so here I'm reading it from Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 158. The Quran itself commanded Muslims to continue practicing the pagan practices as part of the religion. Behold, Safa and Marwa are among the symbols of Allah. It doesn't speak about anything that Dr. Syed said. It is there in the Quran, are among the symbols of Allah, symbols of Allah. It is not written that it is, do it in remembrance, like how the, you know, the bread and wine, that is a do it in remembrance of me type, you know, practice. No, it says among the symbols of Allah. So if those who visit the house in the season or at other side should encompass them around, it is no sin in them. And if anyone obeyeth his impulse to do good, be sure that Allah is he who recognizes and knoweth. This is institutionalized in the Quran in itself. And the late Quranic translator Yusuf Ali states, according to tradition, the lady Hagar, the mother of the infant Ismail, prayed for water in the parched desert, and in her eager quest around the cell, she found a prayer answered and saw the Zamzam spring. This is Yusuf Ali. Many of the Muslims who are reading the Quran is a translation of Yusuf Ali. And it says, unfortunately, the pagan Arabs had placed a male and female idol here, and a gross superstition caused offense to the early Muslims. They felt some hesitation in going around these places during pilgrimage. As a matter of fact, it says, they should have known that the Kaaba had itself been defiled with idols. So there is this. This is the Quranic translator Yusuf Ali has to say, and that is what even the Bible, the Quran has to say. That is, these are the symbols of Allah, and it is institutionalized to go round and round in circles on them. And this is what I had said earlier too. That is, all these practices of doing the namaz, how to sit, what to sit, what to do. We see that in Hinduism rather, when they are doing the prayers. And one sec, I'll show you something else. Yeah. And look at this. Look at this part. All right, everything. Now, this is Muhammad ibn Abdul Karim al-Sharastani admits that most of the Islamic practices of Islam are actual rites performed by pagans. Now, this is said by an Islamic scholar, and he says the Arabs during the pre-Islamic period used to practice certain things that were included in the Islamic Sharia. They, for example, do not marry both a mother and a daughter. They considered marrying two sisters simultaneously to be a most heinous crime. They also censored who married their stepmother and called him Daizan. And they made the major Hajj and the minor Umrah pilgrimage to the Kaaba, performed a circumambulation around the Kaaba, ran seven times between Mount Safa and Marwa, threw rocks and washed themselves after intercourse. They also gargled and sniffed water up their noses, clipped their fingernails, plucked the hair from their armpits, shaved their hair, and performed the rite of circumcision. It is written in the chapter on the opinions of the pre-Islamic Arabs as cited by Al-Fadi, page number 122. This is by an Islamic scholar. All these practices were there in the pre-Islamic era. It was not anything that it had anything to do with Abraham or anything. It was something that Muhammad or his followers patched later on to, give the impression that this is the one true faith. See, now here it is. Here is what I've said. What I had said earlier also. Through his earlier contacts with Jews and Christians, Muhammad knew that their faith centered in Jerusalem, where monotheistic Muhammad abhorred polytheistic worship. Consequently, so he aligned himself with faith that he believed was from the true God. He selected Jerusalem as the direction of prayer, and he hoped that the Jews would receive him as a prophet. That was a move. It was a political move. But after year and a half after the migration to Medina, after the Jews had thoroughly rejected him. And you can see that in Quran chapter 2 verse 144, you can see that he turned the direction of prayer to Mecca. Just as he had compromised, here also he compromised. So now he thought there is no point in continuing, you know, pacifying the Jews. So let me take the way out and then just tell the Jews to go to hell, because now I am very powerful.
All praise be to Allah, the cherisher and sustainer of the worlds, and peace and blessings of Allah be on His Prophet Muhammad, peace upon him and his companions.
Okay, so there it was, the pagan practices which are there in Islam in itself. And then even for the practices of Islam, which included the Muharram fasting, again, it was not something that has been institutionalized or mandated by the Christians or by the Jews. That is, for 30 days, you are supposed to be fasting in this way. And from 6 o'clock in the morning till 6 o'clock in the evening or something, you don't eat anything. And if we trace how it works out, typically speaking, as you can see, Muhammad started off on a good tone, and then he changed everything as per how he thought should be the way it should be. I'll just pull up something. One sec. Okay, so that was there, and as we move ahead,
fast 2 days in remembrance of Moses, 9th, 10th Muharram or 10th, 11th Muharram. So how can it be a pagan practice? It is not a pagan practice. Jesus was circumcised. Circumcision is a token of everlasting covenant. Everlasting covenant. It is not for the time being. It says that circumcision is an everlasting covenant. Let me read verse number 13. He that is born in thy house, and he that is bought with thy money, he that is born in thy house is the Jew, and he that is bought with thy money can be a non-Jew, must needs be circumcised, and my covenant shall be in your flesh for an everlasting covenant. It is not for time being, it is for everlasting covenant. What is the meaning of everlasting covenant? It is not for the only Jews, it is for everlasting covenant. And the uncircumcised man, child, whose flesh of his foreskin is not circumcised, that soul shall be cut off from his people. He had broken my covenant. So the Christians, they have broken the covenant. They are not circumcised. We Muslims are circumcised. We are under covenant. We are under the everlasting covenant. So Muslims have it. Christians do not.
All right. So here again, it is, I answered this in the debate, but it still keeps coming up again and again and again. And I hope that this guy would have some ethics to be, you know, working in a way and answering questions in a more, you know, like a pointed manner. And so let us read that verse again, what he says or claims. Genesis chapter 17, verse 13 to 14. It is simple English. Read. He that is born in that house, and he that is born bought with thy money, must needs to be circumcised. Now, simple question, my brothers and sisters. I ask you, okay, no prizes for guessing the answer, but okay, I'll send you something nice if you answer, all right? So, he that is born in thy house, whom is this God speaking to? Abraham, right? Okay, now, who are the descendants of Abraham called? Who were the descendants of Abraham called? Was it the Muslims? No. Was it the Christians? No. Then it was the Jews. This commandment, by this very verse quoted by this so-called quack of a doctor, Dr. Sayyid, the verse says it very clearly. He that is born in thy house of Abraham. The descendants of Abraham are called Jews. When a Jew gets circumcised, he is following the covenant. I am not a Jew. I don't need to follow this covenant. And in the first get together or the first council that happened in Christian history, which was the Jerusalem Council in Acts chapter 15, if you read, it was decided that it was not a mandate to ask, based on the same things, on the same reasoning, it was not mandated to ask the non-Jewish people who come to Christianity to get circumcised. Because it is primarily not required. That was not the commandment of God. He that is born in that house and he that is bought with thy money must needs to be circumcised. I am neither a slave in a Jewish household and neither am I born in a Jewish household. Had either of that been true, I would have been needed to get circumcised. So is a Muslim a descendant of Abraham? No. Then why on earth are you getting circumcised, my friend? Rather, for you, as for the Muslims, the most of the heinous creatures on earth are the Jews and the Christians. And here you are following a Jewish practice. Secondly, the most abhorrent thing about circumcision in Islam is the most abhorrent, detestable practice of female circumcision. Show me a single verse in the Holy Bible which speaks about female circumcision. It doesn't. Because for the Holy God, a man and a woman is one. He would never institutionalize a female circumcision to be done in the Holy Bible. But for a Muslim, a woman is nothing more than chattel, you know, chattel as cattle, you know, your owner. You're the owner of a woman. She's not supposed to be enjoying any sort of relations. That's why they have something called as female circumcision. A detestable practice, even done today in the Islamic countries, in the very orthodox Islamic cultures. They live horrible lives with infection. Many of them bleed to death. And that, my dear friend, is Islam. You have copied that, stolen that from the Egyptian practices. So Jesus was circumcised, but his mother was not. Jewish women were not. Where did you get the practice of female circumcision? I challenge a Muslim to tie that up with the Holy Bible. I challenge Dr. Syed. If you are in touch with Dr. Syed, I'm waiting online, Dr. Syed. Where art thou? You have been sent the debate challenge and you ran away from Rakshana TV channel, and then you are releasing monologues and you don't even have the guts to come here on Facebook and do a live discussion with me. Going ahead.
And this is not a pagan practice. You talk about Islam as a pagan practice, but what about Christianity?
So then after proving, as I've shown, that Islam is in fact following pagan practices, he comes to Christianity. Now that is the tale for my next session. And again, I request you, I challenge all my Islamic friends, friends to be there, your Islamic friends to be there, tag your Muslim colleagues or whatever to be there. Today is Thursday. I'll be doing this on Saturday evening. And if you are there, I'll be more than happy to take it up. I'll be waiting for Dr. Syed to come online. If you have any questions on my today's presentation, I'm willing to take it up in my next on a live Q&A. I'll be answering the second part, whether Christianity is a copy of paganism, all of the queries. For now, I thank Dr. Syed to have established that whatever is practiced in Islam has got nothing to do with Christianity. It is nothing more than a pagan practice. It was nothing more than abhorrent practices such as female circumcision and perversion of Jewish practices. That's what you did. Matter of fact, I challenge you, since you mentioned about circumcision, I challenge you to prove that even Muhammad himself was circumcised. Please prove it to me. I challenge all Muslims to prove to me that your idol, Muhammad, was circumcised. So that's it for today, my friends. And please, it is just 2 days down the line, I'll be taking up the next topic of whether Islam, whether Christianity is a pagan religion, and I really hope that you'll be there at that time, and that's just 2 days down the line. Be there, and I look forward to hearing from you. Till then, take care, and God bless you. Bye-bye.